Imagine, if you would, with me, a family, mom and dad, three kids, 14, 12, 10. And they've been struggling, and so the parents decide they're going to try a brand new parenting technique with their kids. They're going to decide that the kids can do whatever they want. They want to get up and go to school, they can. Want to take a shower, okay, whatever. You want to eat Takis for breakfast, okay. You want to watch TV and go to bed whenever you want, oh, whatever, it's fine. I mean, come on. Like, none of us would run a household that way, right? There's got to be some rules and structure and some guidelines and some boundaries. Today, we begin our series into the book of Judges. Today is an introduction to the book. There's some foundational material. For the rest of the series, we'll cover one judge or one narrative each week. Now, today, there's a lot to cover. So I'm going to need you to stick with me. Just going to warn you, there's a lot going on in this sermon, okay? So the book of Judges covers about 350 years of history, from the year 1400 B.C. to approximately 1050 B.C., and the theme of the book was the verse that was on that video, the last verse of the Bible, of the Judges, Judges 21, 25. In those days, there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes. Or as it said in that translation, whatever. It's also in Judges 17, 6. And in two other places in the book, it says, in those days, there was no king in Israel. And so the book records a lot of chaos and disorder. A lot of whatever. So how did Israel, this people of God, how did they get to this point? Well, let me do a quick Old Testament history up to the book of Judges. Now, this is going to be quick. If you know some of your Old Testament history, you're going to be right with me. If you're not as familiar, let me encourage you to read through the books of Genesis and Exodus. Okay, don't go into Leviticus. Most people die in Leviticus. So read Genesis and Exodus. Okay, don't study through them, just read through them if you're not familiar. It'll take you maybe an hour or two to read through Genesis and Exodus. But here's a quick history, five movements in the quick review. Number one, God created. Not because he had to, but because he wanted to. And he created humans in his own image to be in relationship with him. Of course, we know they sinned. They broke the purity of the relationship, the forbidden fruit. They're banished from the garden. It's downhill from there. Number two, God chooses Noah to restart relationships with humans, right? We build the ark. We got this great flood. Animals two by two. I don't know why mosquitoes were on the ark. After the waters recede, Noah gets drunk. He's found naked by his boys. It's chaos. It's disorder. It's messed up. Goes downhill from there. Number three, God chooses Abraham. Abraham, I'm going to restart my relationship with humanity through you. I'm going to create a new people through you and through your wife. Man, you're going to be my people. We're going to live in this wonderful relationship. And he promises a son to him and his wife, Sarah. Well, it takes a while. So Sarah says, you know, we got to do something about this. If we're ever going to have kids, we got to do something about this. So they have a son named Ishmael through Sarah's handmaiden. That was not the plan. Then God blesses Sarah with the son Isaac. He's the child of promise. He has a son named Jacob who's renamed Israel, but his name means deceiver. And we get several stories where he's a deceiver. He has 12 sons through four different women. It's messy. It's chaos. It's disorder. But these are the sons that are going to be the 12 tribes of Israel. Well, eventually there's a famine in the land, and so I have to go to Egypt, where one of Jacob's descendants, Joseph, is second in command in Egypt. And they go and live there in the land of Goshen, and they have enough to provide for their families and their flocks. Years later, however, as the book of Exodus begins, the Israelites are enslaved under a new Pharaoh who does not remember Joseph and the people of Israel. And so that leads us to movement four. God chooses Moses to deliver Israel from slavery in Egypt. God spends a whole generation preparing Moses for that job. And Moses leads them out of Egypt. It's a great story. Read it in Exodus or watch the Ten Commandments with Gregory Peck and Yul Brynner. It's awesome. But then Moses sins. Israel complains. God says, why don't you wander for a while? 40 years in the desert, manna, quail, tabernacle. Moses is nearing the end of his life. Number five, God and Moses choose Joshua to be the next leader of the 12 tribes. Joshua leads the people across the Jordan River into the promised land. Yay! The plan was for them to kill or remove the Canaanites in the land. They were pagan worshipers. More on that in a second. But then Joshua dies. Moment of silence. Joshua dies. Okay, Judges begins with the phrase, after the death of Joshua. Okay, so this gets us up to the book of Judges. And up to this point in time, God had moved, God had acted, God had chosen leaders for his people, right? He created people. He chose the descendants of Abraham to be his called out people. He rescued them from slavery. He gave his law through Moses. He was with Joshua as the leader of the people. God did it. He's the leader. He's the initiator. He's in charge of his people. However, when he created people in his own image, he had to give them free will because that's part of who he is. God has free will. So if we were to be created in his image, we had to have it too. And so God knew that even his called out people, his chosen ones, would sometimes choose to disobey. And when that happens, chaos and disorder follows. Man, we'll see this throughout the book of Judges. See, God's plan was always, the mission from his perspective, is that through his people, this people, devoted to God, set apart by him and for him, would shine his light and his truth into the world. They would fail. In fact, that's most of the rest of the Old Testament. But God would still have his light and truth ultimately come to people through the nation of Israel, through his son in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. That's awesome. Now, this is going to seem off topic, but I need you to stick with me for a minute. I have one older sister. I've been married quite a while to my wonderful wife, Deanna. I have three daughters. As a result of all that female influence, I have seen the movie The Sound of Music 50 times. That is no exaggeration. Years ago, my wife and I, my sister, my mom, my stepdad, our kids were too little, but we went to a Sound of Music sing-along. It was awesome. You got to watch the movie, and you literally get to sing all the songs. It was great. They gave you a little bag when you went in there with all kinds of cool little things. For instance, they had a little bouquet of flowers that you could hold up while you were singing Edelweiss, right? They gave you a small swath of cloth, right? When Maria's in the room, they're going, I got to make play clothes for these kids. You're supposed to hold up the cloth and yell, the curtains, right? It was awesome. But then there was one part when we were doing this that when a certain character came onto the screen, we were all supposed to go, boo. And if you're familiar with the movie, you probably know the Baroness. It was the Baroness. We were supposed to shout, boo, right? But it was great because it was active participation. And so I'm going to have some of that for us today. So when we read through part of the book of Judges here at the beginning, when the good guys or the hero messes up, I need you to... Thank you. Very good. Excellent. Excellent. When the good guys or the hero obey God. Yeah. Excellent. You guys are so good at this. Then when we see God do something miraculous and awesome, we're going to applaud. Yeah, that's awesome. Okay. Good. There's our little practice run. Okay. Well done. I'm going to stop here. Let's pray together. God, you are good. You are faithful. We thank you for the opportunity we have now to dig into this book and to see that you are faithful. God, I pray that you would continue to communicate that message to us in lots of ways. We can trust you. So God, just be with us as we open your word. Thank you for this opportunity. It's in your name we pray, amen. Oh, no. Two more things before we get into the text. One, I really wrestled with the structure for this message because there's a lot of content we're going to cover. In my brain, this works as what I might say a three-act play, or what is probably more familiar to us, a movie trilogy. So let's think about a trilogy example, right? In the first movie, we'd be introduced to some characters, some good people, but they'd be recognizing a growing problem of evil. They'd have to band together and come up with a plan to overcome evil. Right, so what we might call that movie, The Fellowship of the Ring. Maybe we'll just call it that. Then the second movie, right, evil increases, villains unite, obstacles occur for those on the quest for what is right and good. Maybe we'd call it The Two Towers. In the third movie, a hero rises and he helps unite people, lead them to victory. Right, so we're going to look at this in kind of a three-movie format, the text for today. Here's the second thing. It's going to be helpful for you to know three Hebrew words in this book. One of these words will be highlighted in each movie. The first word is the word harem. Harem. We're supposed to have it on the screen. There it is. Okay. It means devoted to destruction. It means something is under a ban and it needs to be destroyed because it's impeding the relationship with God. This is an important concept in Judges and actually the whole Old Testament, and I'm going to share several New Testament examples as well. The second word, when we see it, we would pronounce it probably when NASA. Come on, give me that word. I need the next word. There it is, NASA. No, we don't want to hear about that word. But that's not in the Hebrew. That word would more be pronounced NASA. Okay, NASA. This word can be a verb or a noun, and it means to test or a test, to challenge, to try or to bear, to take up. We're going to see this at the end of the second movie. And then the third word is the word shofet, which is what we translate as judge, right? The book of Judges, it's all about these shofets, right? It's closer in meaning, though, to a ruler or a military leader, tribal leader, right? In those days, Israel had no king, so God raised up a shofet, right? A judge to lead. Okay, after the longest introduction to a message ever, let's get into the book. Oh, wait, I have one more thing, actually. Hopefully, you got one of these when you came in. This is a Bible journal. It's got the whole book of Judges in it. It also has places for you to take notes. This is for you. We want you to have this. We want you to have God's word in your hands. It's free. Feel free to take one. However, some of you may want to contribute to the cost to help offset that cost to the church. I will tell you, these cost $3.88 a piece, okay? So if you would like to contribute, you can add some extra money in the offering box at the back. There's no obligation. We want you to have this for free. We want you to read God's word. Okay, that's it. So we'll start with the first movie. We might call it the Fellowship of the Tribes. So let's look at Judges 1:1. After the death of Joshua, the people inquired of the Lord, "Who shall go up first for us against the Canaanites to fight against them?" So they ask, they come up, and they say, "Let's inquire of the Lord." That was a good thing for them to do. To say, "Yes, God, we still have Canaanites, and you've asked us to get rid of them." Right? You've asked us to cleanse the land of the paganism of these Canaanite tribes. So who should go up against them for us? Right? This is good. They inquired of the Lord. God wanted the land cleared of paganism. Let's talk about that for a second. Paganism was the worship of false gods. We'll meet gods in the book of Judges like Baal or Baal, Ashtaroth, Dagon, right? They're worshiped through idols and sacred trees and altars. And these gods would demand a sacrifice of animals, but also a sacrifice of people. And we know, right, from the book of Exodus that God commanded there's to be no idols, there's to be no false gods. He wanted the land for his people to be cleansed. That's the idea of harem. Cleanse the land. Well, let's look at verse 2. The Lord said, "Judah shall go up. Behold, I have given the land into his hands." Behold, God says, I have given the land. God's going to do it. God's going to do it, right? The Lord will fight through them. Judah's the largest of the 12 tribes. And God says, "You, Judah, you're going to go and complete the work of cleansing the land of Canaanites and paganism." But then we look at verse 3. And Judah said to Simeon, his brother, "Come up with me into the territory allotted to me that we may fight against the Canaanites. And I likewise will go with you into the territory allotted to you." So Simeon went with him. Now this seems like a good idea. If you're going to be in a fight, bring your brother along with you, right? That's good strategy. The problem is, that's not what God said. That's not what God said. God said, "Here's the plan. Judah, you're going to go. You're going to go." God didn't say, "Judah, go get your brother Simeon, and you two go together and fight." That's not what God said. God said, "Judah, you're going to go, and I'm going to give you victory. I will give you victory, Judah." And then Judah, in verse 3, says, hey, brother, little brother, come with me. Let's go do this thing together. Man, I think this is so like us as humans, right? Which comes from this human nature of ours, right? For instance, he tells Abraham, "You're going to have a son through your wife, Sarah, even though she's barren and can't have children. But it takes a long time." So Sarah says, "We got to do something about this. Man, we got to make this happen. Like this, God's not coming through here. We got to make this happen." And so she says to Abram, "Hey, why don't you have a child through my handmaid? We'll get this thing started." But that wasn't the plan. That wasn't the plan. Sometimes we take what God said and we think, you know, I gotta amend this plan a little bit. I gotta change this a little bit. Or, you know, we can't wait that long. Clearly God's not gonna come through here, so I gotta take matters into my own hands. Or we think, you know, God doesn't really understand my situation. Here's point number one from movie number one. To be a follower of God, we do what he says. It's just so simple. If we wanna be one of Jesus' disciples, we do what he says. We do what he says. God was asking the Israelites to do what he said. He was their king, and he wanted to be their king. And he said, Judah, you go, and I'll give you victory. But Judah says, well, I got a better idea. I'm going to bring my brother along too. Now, God, in his great grace, even though Judah goes beyond what he says, God's going to give a lot of them victory over the Canaanites. Look at verses 4 and 5, chapter 1. Then Judah went up, and the Lord gave the Canaanites and the Perizzites into their hand, and they defeated 10,000 of them at Bezek. They found Adonai Bezek, that's the leader, at Bezek, and fought against him and defeated the Canaanites and the Perizzites, not parasites, Perizzites. Adonai Bezek fled, but they pursued him and caught him and cut off his thumbs and big toes. We're not going to get into that. What that shows, though, is God is still giving them victory. Judah and his brother Simeon, right? Look at verse 8. Skip down to verse 8. And the men of Judah fought against Jerusalem and captured it and struck it with the edge of the sword and set the city on fire. And afterward, the men of Judah went down to fight against the Canaanites who lived in the hill country, in the Negeb and the lowland. And Judah went against the Canaanites who lived in Hebron. Now the name of Hebron was formerly Kiriath Arba, and they defeated Sheshai and Ahiman and Talmai. Verse 11. From there they went against the inhabitants of Debir, and the name of Debir was formerly Kiriath Sefer. Victory after victory, victory after victory. The Lord did it. The Lord was the victorious one, right? Skip down to verse 117. And Judah went with his brother Simeon, and they defeated the Canaanites who inhabited Zephath and devoted it to destruction. Now in Hebrew, that's the word harem. Devoted to destruction. So the name of the city was called Hormah. But here's where we get harem. This city is devoted to God. We have to destroy paganism. God is wanting to mete out his justice and judgment on those who refused and rejected him. It was devoted to destruction. Look at verse 18. Judah also captured Gaza. Yes, that's the same Gaza that we hear about in the news today. Judah also captured Gaza with its territory, and Ashkelon with its territory, and Ekron with its territory. And the Lord was with Judah. And Judah's doing what he's supposed to. Yay! Judah's fighting and winning victory after victory. And the Lord was with Judah. Even though he'd gone beyond what God had said, he's still with him and bringing victory after victory. But look at the rest of verse 19. And the Lord was with Judah. And he took possession of the hill country, but he could not drive out the inhabitants of the plain because they had chariots of iron. But that's such an important preposition. I've made a joke in different Bible studies I've led over the year, and I've said, there's some really important buts in the Bible. There's some really big buts in the Bible. This is one of them. But he could not drive out the inhabitants of the plain. I mean, they had chariots of iron. Phew, that's tough. Chariots of iron, that would be hard to fight against. I don't know, maybe that was too much for God. Maybe chariots of iron was like kryptonite for God. Just too much. No. They did not, could not drive out. Then look at verse 21. But, there it is again. But the people of Benjamin did not drive out the Jebusites who lived in Jerusalem. So the Jebusites have lived with the people of Benjamin in Jerusalem to this day. And this starts a long pattern where God has said, I've called you to go into the land and drive these people out. But they haven't done it. They haven't done it, even though the Lord was with them. And so it starts this pattern. In verse 27, Manasseh did not drive out Verse 28, when Israel grew strong, they put the Canaanites to forced labor, but did not drive them out. Verse 29, Ephraim did not drive out. Verse 30, Zebulun did not drive out. Verse 31, Asher did not drive out the inhabitants of Akko. Verse 33, Naphtali did not drive out the inhabitants of Beth Shemesh. Did not do it. God had said, this is harem. You are to destroy the paganism in the land. You are to drive out these people or kill these people because they will not recognize me as the Lord God. You need to get them out of your land. But they don't. They don't. Instead, they were going to be a snare. And we would end movie number one there. It's a cliffhanger. What's going to happen? Right? The good guys had some victories. They worked together. But ultimately, they disobeyed. What's going to happen? Well, we'd have to wait till the second movie. We don't have to wait a year, though, so that's good. Well, let's think about applying this to our context. Man, there's so many examples of what I'm about to talk about. If someone's a Christian, right, at some point in time, they said, yes, Jesus, you are the Christ, you are the King, I want you to be Lord of my life. They repent of their sinful ways of thinking and living. They get baptized into Christ, and they plan to live for him. They commit their life to him. But we live in a world that is still filled with what I might call modern-day paganism, where, for instance, other people, like celebrities and politicians, are worshipped instead of God. We live in a world where people sacrifice their children for their work or for their gambling habit or their drug addiction or their extramarital affair. We live in a world where greed and lust and overindulgence are glorified, and we want to follow God, right? We committed our way to the Lord. But we're tempted to be drawn into the ways of the world. Man, I'm guilty of this. I can look back on my life and see times where I blatantly disobeyed God, even though I had committed my life to Jesus. The cost. There's a cost to being one of God's people. For us, we're Jesus' disciples. So the cost for being Jesus' disciples, right, since we live under the new covenant, is that when we commit ourselves to the Lord, there's going to have to be some harem. There's going to be some things that we have to devote to destruction because those things lead us away from him. I had a great youth minister growing up. Still friends with him to this day. Years after it happened, he told me once about one of our kids in the youth group when I was in it, who after we'd gone to a summer conference, this young man had been convicted about the music they were listening to. And so the teenager one day brought a case of 50 cassette tapes to the youth minister and asked him to get rid of those tapes. Harem. That young man chose to destroy something of value to him, right? His secular music for something better. He wanted a better relationship with Jesus. Harem. There's two examples from the New Testament regarding harem. One's a yay, one's a boo. The first one comes in the book of Acts. The Apostle Paul travels to Ephesus in Acts chapter 19. Great story. There's miracles, people respond to the gospel, and here's what Luke records in Acts 19, verses 18 to 20. Acts 19, 18 to 20. Luke records, also many of them who are now believers came confessing and divulging their practices. And a number of those who had practiced magic arts brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all. And they counted the value of them and found it came to 50,000 pieces of silver. And so the word of the Lord continued to increase and prevail mightily. That's harem. I used to be involved in these things, and it led me away from the Lord, and they're an obstacle to my relationship with the Lord. So I'm going to burn those things. I'm going to devote them to destruction. I don't care what era we're talking about. 50,000 pieces of silver is a lot of money. But they said it's more important now that we have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Harem. Now, the second story is of the rich young ruler. It's found in Mark chapter 10. It's a great story again. Mark chapter 10, verse 21 says this, and Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, you lack one thing. go, sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Jesus says, you got all this money, but your money is getting in the way of a relationship with me. You need to harem your money. Devote to destruction that which is getting in the way between us. And he says, so go and sell all you have and give to the poor. And then we get to verse 22 of Mark 10. Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. I'd hold up the boo, but it's almost too sad to hold up the boo. No harem. He was unwilling to devote to destruction that which was in the way of his relationship with Jesus. There's a cost to being one of God's people. There was for those people way back then in the book of Judges. And there's a cost for us too. And we may have to harem a few things and say, I got to destroy this in my life because it's an obstacle. It's an impediment to my relationship with God. Harem. Well, we'd get to movie number two. Maybe we'd call it the Canaanites. Now, it starts with God's perspective in chapter two of Judges. So the author backs up a bit to before movie number one. So, like, it's kind of weird, but we've seen this before. It's like the sequel starts with the prequel, okay? That's how chapter two works. So look at chapter two of Judges. Now, the angel of the Lord went up from Gilgal to Bochim. And he said, I brought you up from Egypt and brought you into the land that I swore to give to your fathers. I said, I will never break my covenant with you. And you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. Those are the Canaanites. You shall break down their altars, harem. But you have not obeyed my voice. What is this you have done? So now I say, I will not drive them out before you. But they shall become thorns in your sides, and their gods shall be a snare to you. As soon as the angel of the Lord spoke these words to all the people of Israel, the people lifted up their voices and wept. And they called the name of the place Bochim, which means weeping, and they sacrificed there to the Lord. When Joshua dismissed the people of Israel went each to his inheritance to take possession of the land. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great work that the Lord had done for Israel. And Joshua, son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. And they buried him within the boundaries of his inheritance at Timnath-Heres in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the mountains of Gaash. And all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work he had done for Israel. Oof. Talk about a boo, right? Oops. This is point number two from movie number two. God's people are to communicate about God to the next generation. It's our responsibility. And it starts with parents in the home, right? It's our job as parents to communicate to our children about God and his ways and his work and what he's done in our lives. We need to pass that on to them. And then the church partners with parents, right, in helping lead children and students and the next generation to hear about God and his will and his ways and how he works. And so we are so thankful here at Bridgetown for all of those who volunteer right now who are serving with our kids and with our Bridgetown students, right? They're partnering with parents and seeking to pass on stories of God to the next generation. So let's give them a round of yes. We are thankful. We are thankful for our staff and volunteers who are working with our kids and students to pass that on. They're partnering with us because that's our responsibility. It's part of what it means to be one of God's people. We're passing on the stories and the truth and the work of God to the next generation. Well, the rest of movie number two would describe a cycle that's repeated throughout the book of Judges. It begins at verse 11. Here's what's recorded. Chapter 2 of Judges. And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals. And they abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after other gods from among the gods of the peoples who were around them and bowed down to them. And they provoked the Lord to anger. They abandoned the Lord and served the Baals and the Asheroth. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them. And he sold them into the hands of their surrounding enemies so that they could no longer withstand their enemies. Whenever they marched out, the hand of the Lord was against them for harm, as the Lord had warned and as the Lord had sworn to them. And they were in terrible distress. Then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hand of those who plundered them. Yet they did not listen to their judges, for they whored after other gods and bowed down to them. They soon turned aside from the way in which their fathers had walked, who had obeyed the commandments of the Lord, and they did not do so. Whenever the Lord raised up judges for them, the Lord was with the judge, and he saved them from the hand of their enemies all the days of the judge. For the Lord was moved to pity by their groaning because of those who afflicted and oppressed them. But whenever the judge died, they turned back and were more corrupt than their fathers, going after other gods, serving them and bowing down to them. They did not drop any of their practices or their stubborn ways. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel. And he said, because this people have transgressed my covenant that I commanded their fathers and have not obeyed my voice, I will no longer drive out before them any of the nations that Joshua left when he died. In order to test Nassau, in order to test Israel by them, whether they will take care to walk in the ways of the Lord as their fathers did or not. So the Lord left those nations, not driving them out quickly, and he did not give them into the hand of Joshua. So that whole passage describes a cycle. We have a slide with it here. I would encourage you to, maybe if you're taking notes, put this in your notes, okay? Because we'll see this throughout the entire book of Judges, right? It just previewed here at the end of chapter 2, right? It starts off, number one, the people fall into sin and idolatry. They start worshiping the gods of the Canaanites. And then number two, God is angry. That's what he just said. That's not what I told you to do, right? You're my people. Stop doing this, right? God is angry. So then he says, other people are going to oppress you and plunder you, right? They're going to capture you. You're going to be sold into their hands, right? Because of their disobedience. But then the people eventually will cry out, God, we forgot about you. God, please hear us. We forgot about you. And God, in his mercy, in his grace, will send a shofet, a judge, right, to bring them a military victory so they could have peace in the land, right? That's number six. And while the judge is alive and God is with that judge and bringing salvation, physical salvation through that judge, there's peace in the land. But then the judge will die, and then the cycle will start over again. And we see this again in the beginning of chapter 3. Now, these are the nations that the Lord left to test Israel. That is, all in Israel who had not experienced all the wars in Canaan. It was only in order that the generations of people of Israel might know war, to teach war to those who had not known it before. These are the mountains, the five lords of the Philistines, and all the Canaanites, and the Sidonians, and the Hivites who lived on Mount Lebanon, from Mount Baal Hermon as far as Lebo Hamath. They were for the testing of Israel, to know whether Israel would obey the commandments of the Lord, which he commanded their fathers by the hand of Moses. So the people of Israel lived among the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. It's a lot of ites hanging around. And their daughters they took to themselves for wives, and their own daughters they gave to their sons, and they served their gods. The key word in the second movie is Nassau, test. Challenge. As a result of their disobedience, right, as a failure because they forgot to pass on knowledge of God to the next generation, because they didn't drive the people out, God was now going to use those other nations, those other people groups to test them, to test the Israelites, to see if they would repent and obey. See, each judge and each cycle was an opportunity for the people of Israel to repent and obey. It was a test, a burden, a challenge, Nassau. Sometimes I'm tempted to think this way. I think other Christians are too. I'm tempted to think, why doesn't God just send Jesus back and take us out of this evil world? Or I think, why doesn't God just take like all the evil out of the world so that we don't have to wrestle with it? Well, according to what we see in the biblical book of Judges, God allows his people to make choices, and then he rescues them, but he still keeps them in the world to test them to see if they will obey. These tests, these challenges, and struggles were opportunities to see if the Israelites would repent and obey. Could it be that even though we've committed to Jesus and he has saved us and redeemed us, that we still face tests and challenges, because then they're opportunities for us to repent and choose to obey. Well, movie number two would come to an end. And we, the readers, would know God's plan. Hadn't been revealed yet to all the Israelites, but we would know as the audience, we would know what God's plan is. And we would wait and long for movie number three. The movie where the hero rises, right, and brings their celebration and victory. And so we're going to read here quickly about the first judge, the first Shophet. We're not going to do a whole sermon on Othniel, so let me read it here for you in Judges chapter 3, verse 7. And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. They forgot the Lord their God and served the Baals and the Asheroth. Therefore, the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he sold them into the hands of Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Mesopotamia. And the people of Israel served Cushan-Rishathaim 8 years. But when the people of Israel cried out to the Lord raised up a deliverer for the people of Israel who saved them, Othniel, the son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother. The Spirit of the Lord was upon him, and he judged Israel. He went out to war, and the Lord gave Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Mesopotamia, into his hands, and his hand prevailed over Cushan-Rishathaim. So the land had rest for 40 years. Then Othniel, the son of Kenaz, died. God raised up Othniel. Here's point three for movie number three. Even when God's people are not faithful, God is. Oh, man. They disobeyed. They worshiped other gods. They got drawn into the paganism of the world. They forgot about the Lord. And the Lord was angry. But then they remembered and said, oh, we're supposed to be followers of God. What are we doing? They repented and they cried out. And God, who is so faithful, says, I will rescue you again. And he does by sending a Shophet, a ruler, a leader for his people. Even when God's people disobey, when they repent and cry out, God is there and he hears their prayer and he answers. He is for his people. Even when we as Christians disobey, we repent and we confess our sins. And as 1 John 1:9 says, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He is faithful when we are not. He is just because he paid for our faithlessness, our disobedience through Jesus on the cross. He did that through Christ on the cross. Okay, I was working on this and I was like, this is so good. Don't miss this. Catch this. Jesus was harem. Jesus was devoted to destruction because of the sin of humanity. God said, I'm gonna send my perfect son to earth, and I'm gonna send him to be killed on the cross so that it can clear away all the sin that stands between humanity and me. He came, as it says in Mark 10:45, to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus was harem. He was devoted to destruction so that you and I could have a relationship with the living God. What? That is unbelievable. He was born to die on that cross, to clear the way of all the sin that stood between us and God. Jesus also endured Nassau. Jesus was tested. He was tempted. He was challenged, but he endured and he conquered. He overcame. Where Israel failed, Jesus did not. And where we fail, he will not. And when we're not faithful, he will be. Jesus went through every Nassau, and he conquered them all. And Jesus was Shophet, a ruler, a judge, a leader like no other, leading people into the kingdom of God, conquering our enemy, sin, on the cross. That which oppresses us and enslaves us, our sin, he conquered it because he's our Shophet. He's our ruler and our military leader. This is summed up a little bit in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 2 through 4, where the author says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, anasa, he went through it, despising the shame. And he's seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. But he did. He was harem, so that we could live in relationship with God. He shed his blood. He endured the cross. He passed the test. He conquered sin. For you and for me. And for anyone who will cry out to God and say, save me, help me. Clear these things away so I can be in relationship with you. He was harem. And he is our shofet. And he passed every nasa. And in just a minute, we're going to take communion together. But before we do that, our worship team's going to lead us in the song, Great is Your Faithfulness. I'm going to encourage you to remain seated. If you know the words, maybe just close your eyes. I just want us to spend a few moments reflecting on the power and the grace and how amazing Jesus is. That he would come to earth knowing that his very purpose was to die on the cross. So that all that sin could be cleared away. So that we can be in relationship with our Creator. Man, that's incredible. In spite of our disobedience, God is faithful. It's a small piece of bread. It represents the body of Jesus Christ nailed to that cross because God is faithful. Because he never, ever wanted to live apart from us. He wanted to live in relationship with us. And the death of Jesus on the cross made that possible. Let us eat in remembrance of Jesus. And this small amount of juice symbolizes the blood that he shed to pay the price so that your sin was covered, my sin was covered. Anyone who would cry out to him, their sin would be covered because of who he was and because he died on the cross for us. Let us drink in remembrance of him. And I'm going to ask you.